He's probably doing that right now.
He liked this picture. He took this picture. This was his choice. Oh, yeah. He had it, this is the one he had made. He had it professionally taken and doctored up and he put it on LinkedIn and he put it. So this was good. This is what he liked of himself. See, I would have picked him with a clear face, but this is what he wanted. And it's an older shot. No, no, it's actually, he picked it up. Let me go make sure.
Can I ask everyone to buy their seats?
Are those girls both yours?
No, they're my nieces.
Yeah, what?
My nieces. They're Christie's. My sister's daughter.
Are those your girls?
They're my nieces.
Beautiful girl.
Thank you.
Are they twins?
They're still together. That's my daughter, she's Teresa.
14 months.
14 months.
The one who thinks she's a superstar is my daughter.
Oh, this is your daughter?
Yeah, she thinks she's a superstar. I'm trying to get this show on the road.
You okay there, babe? Give me your piece so far.
Good morning, thank you for being with us today. I'm Pastor Mark. We are here to remember and to give thanks for the life of Cornell and also to offer comfort to the family. The program is intended to be just a guideline. We'll do as much of that as we can, follow it as much as we can. There'll be a chance, though, a time for personal remembrances or just words that you would like to speak to the family. And we'll give you a chance to do that. You can either do that where you are, or you can come up and stand up here in front of the microphone and do that. I'd like us to pray together as we begin our memorial time together. Let's pray. Our Father, thank you for Cornell's life, for the people that he loved, for the things that he was able to accomplish. Thank you, Lord, for giving him political freedom. Thank you, Lord, that he was a strong worker. And he left a great legacy of being responsible and working hard, loving his country that he came to be part of. We thank you, Lord, for the long years of marriage that he and Jocelyn were able to enjoy. We thank you, Father, for the way that he undertook the suffering that he had to go through. Thank you for his strength and how he tried to protect others from all of his pain and his suffering. We ask, Father, now that you comfort the family, continue to do so, and that we will remember him in an appropriate way today, Lord. Remember the good things of his life and the love that he had for others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to invite you to come, and those who would like to do so, stand and sing with us. Mallory Benjamin, one of Cornell's nieces, is going to come and lead us.
Yes, please stand with us as we begin singing. This is one of the worship songs that was requested by Jocelyn for his very comforting words.
Oh,
John 14, 1 through 3. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. I'm sorry. My Father's house has many rooms. If there were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am.
Thank you.
What a beautiful reflection that was of such a cultured and interesting and loving man. In all of his family, some of whom I had the pleasure of meeting, some of whom I haven't. That was beautiful. We're going to be stay seated at this time, and you can just listen to the words of this next song and let them comfort you. another scripture reading from Eileen.
Okay, I'm better this time. I'll be reading from 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 14 and Romans 8:38 through 39. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind. You have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
At this time, we would ask you all to stand and if you would like to sing along with this last worship song that Jocelyn has requested, and let it comfort you to remember that the God we serve is the light in our darkness. I worship you. maybe seated at this time.
The obituary, I'm sorry, the obituary will be read by Gabrielle.
Eulogy.
Yeah, you're not quite the same. And I think we'll have some time for you to share some remembrances or other thoughts that you'd like to share with the family.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's 1 minute to the afternoon. I want to thank you, Jocelyn, for allowing me to share these thoughts with you today on this day. We're gathered here to honor, to remember, to say goodbye, and to celebrate the life of Carnell. He was a beloved husband, son, nephew, he was my cousin, brother-in-law, uncle, and respected friend. All our lives have been touched by him, in some way, big or small, and that is why we're here today. I thought I'd share a couple of details about his life that not all of you may know. So he was born May 7th, 1948, Corneliu Popovici in Bucharest, Romania. He was the only child of his parents, Eugen and Eugenia, and he was the grandson of a Romanian Orthodox priest. He spent his early childhood overcoming medical challenges. He had to heal from a very serious back injury and tuberculosis. And as a young kid, when others were playing outside, he had to wear a corset and he couldn't do much. And that lasted several years. So from that time, you could see what a tenacious and tough person he was, because he overcame all that. And later, he was able to play basketball, he was able to play volleyball. And as we saw in the slides earlier, he even did Taekwondo later in life. Who would have thought? When he graduated from college in 1966, his first thought was to leave Romania. Romania at the time had an awful communist regime, and he just couldn't bear it. And like many others, followed his dream and escaped. He spent some time in Austria as a refugee for about a year before he was granted entry into the United States. And in 1969, he was able to board a plane and come to New York City and pursue the American dream. The first decade, like most immigrants, is a little bit bewildering, so he spent learning the language, getting accustomed to how life works here. But he soon he pursued his dream of being an entrepreneur. He didn't like the idea of having a boss. A boss, what is that? Who needs a boss? So he started a whole bunch of companies, initially in marketing and advertising. He employed many people, and he was very happy doing so. In 1978, so about 10 years after arriving here, he was able to get American citizenship, and that was a very proud day for him in 1978. He was exactly 30 years at the time, or 30 years old. In 1985, he met Jocelyn, and 1 year later, they got married. Thank you for inviting me to the wedding. I remember that day. It was a beautiful day. We saw the pictures there. It was a bright, beautiful, sunny day. They lived a full, happy, and vibrant life, and they were married together for 35 years. They recently celebrated that anniversary. That is truly impressive and astonishing. Cornell himself, as I mentioned, he was tough as nails. He was very hardworking, very intelligent, very inquisitive, and he had, as we already heard, many interests and talents. He was interested in physics, in astronomy, in music, jazz, rock, musica latina. Hey, you know, he loved it. He loved going to the theater, to the ballet, to the opera. He was also a licensed glider pilot. Who would have thought that? Not me. I'm afraid to get on a plane. But later on, he also got his sailing certification. So air, land, and sea, he did it all. When it comes to food, he was a very sophisticated guy. He could pick up a great wine with a very fancy meal, but also stuff his face with cheeseburgers and fries, like all of us like. He also occasionally liked to get his fix of Romanian comfort food. You may have seen there was one picture there of him and with actually my son and myself at a Romanian restaurant having a good old time. He was strong, he was caring, he was a supportive uncle, cousin, and he loved to share. He loved to share toys with his nieces, right? And some of you may remember, right? Playing on his motorcycle, shooting his air gun, playing with his bows and arrows, and of course, peeking through the telescope. That was a big deal. So he could see the stars and the greatness that awaits us there. His mother-in-law, who was legally blind, was able actually to get a glimpse of Saturn through that telescope. So in closing, Cornell lived a well-rounded life. He was a fighter until the end, and from the very beginning, as I mentioned earlier, he had to fight hard in his life, and he did. He overcame all the obstacles that life threw at him, and he relentlessly pursued his dreams. He was loved, respected, and he will be dearly missed because the world was a better place and certainly a more interesting place with him in it. Now, on a personal note, I'll say that he was also very passionate. There was really no kind of halfway measure or minimum effort. If you were going to do something, you had to do it right and put your heart in it. Otherwise, it is just not worth it. I also like to say, he was a great teacher. He did have many interests, and we talked about all those things later in life. We had spent a lot of time talking about investing, how to beat Wall Street. That was one of his passions. Wall Street is a bunch of idiots there. So he unfortunately ran out of time before he could prove that, but to me he proved, and he was a very good teacher. And I know that was not his chosen career, but he would have made a very good teacher. He was very patient. He would explain things over and over again until he got through my thick head. So he was really a special person. I'm very sad to be here today. But thank you.
First, I want to say, if you've seen that commercial, the Dasakis commercial, the most interesting man in the world, I think they made that character about him. Everything I read in the program saying, it can't even touch how much of a teacher, how cultured, how passionate Cornell was, and how much he really cared about people. And one thing he always taught was to always be your own boss, to work for yourself. For me, Cornell made a huge impact on my life. I'm trying to fight the tears, so. He taught me everything, how to communicate with people outside of where I was from, how to carry myself as a man, how to be responsible, accountable. He taught me how to shoot, he taught me how to fight, how to survive in the woods. He taught me, about the market. He was a phenomenal man. To sit here and hear everybody's speak on him, and it's like I'm just realizing that he's gone, So, also I wanted to say, he did karate. He would hurt you for saying taekwondo. It's karate, traditional karate.
One day she said to me, I'd like to be the nice guy. I said, that's weak. My friend Cornell says to me, I'd like to be the nice girl. Two months later, engagement. So he was a great guy.
Thank you. Matchmaker. I'm sure you've said words of comfort already to Jocelyn, so it's not important that you stand up and say anything. I want to give a chance to be there.
Everyone that's here today, it truly does mean a lot. And just seeing how many people are here shows how many people that Cornell is able to reach in some sort or type of way. If there's anything I could describe my uncle as, particular and meticulous. I remember one time I was playing a chess game with my brother Justin. I made a move that wasn't by the books and he was sure to let me know. But he always had a lesson to teach, no matter how small it was. And honestly, we don't have many good men like him in this world anymore. He's a fantastic role model, and if I could just be a fraction of the man that he was, it'd mean a lot. Thank you all again for coming.
Cornell was a funny man. Not funny, haha. Just a very unique and interesting person. Like Gabrielle said, everything had to be done. It was like no halfway. I remember one time talking to him and saying, Americans, why Americans so lazy? They have everything. I went through so much to get here. It disturbed him. It really did. But he was a good man. And everything, he lived life full. And everything he did with everything he had. And when he loved with everything he had. And he loved all of us. And he would go to his house and he didn't care how much he would spend to throw a spread and just to eat. And the funniest thing about him was he would make this giant plate full and eat a little and cover it and go back like a cat, who he loved, by the way. His pets were his children. But I used to always think that was just the quirkiest thing. But his sayings were funny because he didn't know English. So sometimes he'd say, Eileen, translate that for me. I don't know what you're saying. You know, he just was so curious about everything, and he was so well read. His bookcases filled, everything, art. He was so cultured and just such a good guy. And I just, like Justin said, I'm blessed and a better person because I am him.
But those of us who are to the Bible and they revere it as God's special revelation to us. Now, by that I mean that God spoke through the human authors, the human speakers and human writers who penned the words of the scripture. If we were to look at life from a totally natural perspective, we would assume that death is the end. That death, the implacable foe, the invincible enemy, is going to win, and that's the end. But God's word tells us that there is a whole other realm that exists beyond the natural. It's the realm of the spiritual. And because that realm exists, and because there's a God over that realm, and because he's revealed himself to us, we can know not only about that realm, but what he is doing in that realm that affects us here on the earth. And so we come to the place of death and we look at the urn and we say, that's for, you know, Cornell or my aunt or my mother or your sister. And we say, that's it. That's the end. That's all that's left. But we come to God's word, and God's word tells us that death has been defeated by God's Son, Jesus Christ. That Jesus came into the world not just to teach us great moral teachings, which he did, but to wrestle with death and prevail. And so the Bible tells us that Jesus rose from the dead on the third day, became the conqueror of death, and he now offers eternal life to all who will come to him, humble themselves, acknowledge their need for his saving work on the cross, and invite him into their life and into their heart. Then, according to his promise, all who believe in him have eternal life and will never perish, but will in fact live forever. Listen to what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. He's talking about the passing of being a mortal person. And he says, that's not the end. He said, this perishable, that's our perishable body, must put on the imperishable. And this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable shall have put on the imperishable, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then will have come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, many of us live with the fear of the sting of death. For we either do not know what is on the other side, or we don't believe there is another side. But the Bible, God's word, reveals, yes, there is another side. There is a place, as Eileen read, that Jesus is preparing for those who are his followers, who have believed in him, a house in heaven. The New Testament talks about new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness will dwell, and in which God's children, his family, will live forever. Now, the doorway to that new way of existence, that immortal, imperishable life, is the doorway of death. We all have to go through. But on the other side is eternal and abundant life. Life lived without suffering and pain and sorrow. Lived without decay. But lived with all the joy and the peace that the infinite God of this universe can provide. Paul said in the opening verses of this chapter what the message was that he preached. It was so simple. He could boil it down in just a few points. He said, brethren, I make known to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received. These were believers that he was writing to, in which you stand. That is, that's what they're putting their trust in. By which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you of first importance that which also I received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day, according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, that is to Peter, and then to the 12, to the other apostles. The good news is very simple. God came to do something to change our eternal destiny, to turn us away from a horrible place that Jesus called hell, to an amazing place where he himself dwells and his Father dwells. To do this, though, he had to pay the ultimate sacrifice. He had to die. But not just die as a human being, as Cornell died, but to die as a substitute for us. For the Bible tells us the wages of sin is death. We deserve to be paid for our sin is death. And that's not just physical death, for all of us physically die, but that's spiritual death. It's the loss of life before God. Because the rest of that verse says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus. We earn one thing, but we can be the receivers of something else, a gift, eternal life. And Jesus died on the cross for our sins. He took our place. God punished him so we would not have to be punished for our sins. And then Paul goes on to say that he was buried. There's no question that he died. He was laid in a tomb. He laid there for 3 days. He was guarded by Roman soldiers. But on the third day, it was discovered that his body was not in that tomb. The soldiers had fled. The stone had been rolled away. And then Jesus, alive, appeared to Peter and the 12. And if we were to read on in chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians, we'd see dozens, in fact, a number of hundreds of people recorded who saw Jesus alive during the 40-day period between his death and his ascension into heaven. He rose from the dead. Now, Jesus is still alive, and he's still available to each of us to receive forgiveness of our sin and the gift of eternal life. And so if we would turn to Christ in repentance and humility, and we would say, Lord, I'm one of those sinners that you died for, and I want to receive your gift, that wonderful gift of eternal life, then we can know that in our life, death has finally been defeated. Yes, we may die, but death is no longer the end. It's the doorway to a life far better than we could ever imagine here on the earth. Let's pray. You may want to pray this little simple prayer. Jesus, thank you for dying for me. I am one of those sinners you died for. And I'm sorry for my sin, but all my sorrow can't erase it. So I ask you to come into my heart and into my life. I receive the wonderful gift of eternal life that you offer me at no charge. And I now believe that you are my Savior and the one who will get me to heaven when I die. Thank you for defeating death for me so that I can have eternal life. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, our service is completed. I know all of you are invited downstairs for some lunch after the service is over. So if you find across the hallway or just to the left as you go out the main doors, you'll see exit signs, and that will take you downstairs. Cameron did want to say something. He was shaking and said no a little while ago. You want to come up? Come on up. Well, you can stand there and say it. That's fine. That's fine.